So, yeah, welcome to kind of a MOOC masterclass today. So, what I want to show you today are, I'm not going to explain like how like a subtractive synth is working, because I think, I hope you all know it, and there are tons of tutorials out there in YouTube which you can watch, like what is a filter, what are envelopes and stuff like that. But rather, I want to show you some tricks I found along the way, which are really nice, I think, and I'm more into like a harmonic kind of melodic techno-ish scene, if you know me. My name is Yannick Mount, obviously. So I'm gonna get directly into patching, because I don't think that talking is so interesting. But I have a basic concept, which is this. I fucked it up yesterday. So, I always like to start with init patches, which is possible on the MOOC, on this init knob here.
Could you show it on the Beamer?
Now we need the, like this picture here.
Hello.
Yeah. Perfect. So you can initialize the patch here if you press long, and then you have like the init sound. Yeah, and the init sound sounds always like this, and I already have some, sorry?
Yeah.
I already have some effects on, which is just a basic delay with a dotted eighth rhythm. It's a replica from Native Instruments and a Valhalla Vintage Verb, little bit mix. And I really like to start, with FX on, because I think you can patch for a really long time. And with no FX, it sometimes doesn't feel quite nice, and sometimes then you patch like for 1 hour, and maybe the thing that which is missing is the delay or the reverb. So that the MOOC itself is not making any reverb or delay. So we have this init patch, right? I'm gonna click out all the oscillators which are not turned on at the moment. So this is just a raw saw wave, and I start every patch kind of in the same way, which means I now will modify the init patch to make it like a Mounts-ish init patch, which would mean that this is like a really unnatural sound, this is like big, and then it's gone, and if you like plug a like an electric guitar or whatever violin, like the sound is fading out quite nicely. So what I would do now is turn up the decay and the release. And now you have like a natural kind of a shape for the sound. And this is just really, you can do this to taste. I can turn it down now to and over exaggerate it a little bit. But I'm gonna turn off the effects for a moment. So now it gets like, for me, it gets nice, And then it's just for taste or what you want to achieve with the sound. And then I don't use like the sustain knob at all. I'm using it if I want to do like really a bass which is laying all the time. But for me, I really like the natural dynamic kind of sounds which are after a time just falling down a little bit, so I just turn this down. And now we have like, or that's for me like the perfect init patch. Yeah, and then we can start. And this is like, I'm gonna start all my patches, which I'm gonna show you, from like this state of point where I just adjust the amp like I did at the moment, so I don't have to explain it all the time when I do it again. Okay, so the first patch I'm gonna show you is something I found out randomly in the studio, and it's a patch which Stefan Butzin, I think, uses, or like the settings of the patch. And the patch goes like this. You have your basic sound, only one oscillator at the moment, and then you turn on a second oscillator. turn it up an octave, make it higher. And then turn it up, you can turn it up a fifth here, so it's here it's like saying seven. It's seven semitones, which is like a fifth. You turn it up a fifth. Okay. And now what's the interesting thing about this is you have this glide here. And you can put the glide only on one oscillator. And we're just gonna put it on the one with the fifth. And then we're gonna turn it up, activate it down here. So it's working. And now what we have is, I mean, we didn't even use the filter at the moment, but. And if we make more glide in it, and the longer the distance gets between the tones, the longer the glide will be. You know, and you have like this one tone, which is directly at the pitch you want to achieve, which is kind of important so that you don't, you know, if you have it on both, always active. It's also cool, but yeah, I don't know. This is just the way I think it works a lot better. So the second oscillator is like sliding into the first one. Yeah, and then. Really nice effect. We can add a sub oscillator on that. Now you get something quite nice. Yeah, I mean, we didn't even use the filter to that extent, so it was turned up all the time, so I like to turn it all the way down. And I mean, like basic filter, you have the filter, you turn it down, there's no frequency anymore. You don't hear anything, all the frequency is filtered out. And then you turn up the envelope amount, which says how much the filter opens in the way you're gonna tell it to open, which is the way this filter envelope is set up. So that's the point where you can turn the amount up, how much the filter is gonna be affected by the envelope. Now there's nothing because it's in it, and you have to turn up the decay here. You know, now that's a really important point, because you have like the nice amp envelope which we made in the beginning, and it's really dynamic. But because you haven't turned up the decay of the filter, the release of the filter, it also sounds like ging. It's just gone, you know, it's not dynamic anymore. So you also have to turn up the release here. Turn up the filter cutoff a little bit so the frequencies don't get filtered out so much. Longer decay. Longer release. Yeah, I think that's fucking nice. No? And if you want to, I mean, and then you can just adjust the glide time. So now it's pretty long. And if you would play really fast notes, it would get maybe confusing because the pitch arrives not at the right time. And what I'm playing like piano-wise, I have this plug-in, you can see it here. C minor scale, and I'm really like just changing between C minor, F minor, and some major chords in the scale, and a lot of thirds. And then you just really jam around with it, find your settings, adjust the filter a little bit. So I'm gonna just play for a couple minutes so you get a feeling. We need a longer decay here at the amp envelope. Cool about this long amp envelope is that when it fades out, it gets quiet, and then in the end, if you use the pitch wheel a little bit, you can give it like a slow or like a little bit of modulation in the end, which makes it like really, really nice, so listen. You know, but only in the end, not in the beginning. So it gets really interesting, the sound then. Which is also, which you can also make, if we would had a more closed sound now, which means less filter envelope and less open filtering. Yeah, something like that. I'm gonna make it a little bit louder here. Okay, that's something you have to adjust. If you play more closed sounds, you sometimes have to make it like the whole synth louder, and then you have to watch out that the open sounds don't get too loud, because like the analog gear is really getting really loud if you have the high frequencies coming in. So, really closed sound, and what we can do now in the end is we have two LFO sections here, which is just a, you know, LFO, low frequency oscillator. And we can send this one to the filter, and then it's gonna give us this, you know, the sound. But I don't like it if I do it right away, but rather like what I did with the pitch wheel in the end. So you have like a sound like. And then. That adds like a really, yeah, interesting character to the end of the sound, and you are not like, because if you're using it all the time, it can get a little bit too much for my taste. But I mean,
are you doing this every time manually, or do you automate it in the
I actually like to do it manually, so I don't automate any filter, like LFO, I never automated. So I mean, I have like a little bit of a whatever beat here. And I mean, I also don't sync the LFO to the, I mean, you could sync it here to the arpeggiator, which is then synced to the DAW. But I personally like it more to let it be out of sync, especially in breaks and stuff like that, so I can, if this would be the break. And I mean, if you hear like the rhythm in the back, you also get a feeling if you control it when it has to get slower and faster, and that's, but you have to develop it on your own. So I would do something, I don't know. But yeah, also really important thing for like the whole, for my process of how I do the sounds is I used to record all, everything I do, I record it. So if this would be like a jam session where I would jam around, make a track, I would record really everything, because in the end you know, you never know when you're gonna play the nice stuff. And because it's, because I personally get faster to like results without automating it all, it's really important that you have everything you play, you know. And I mean, I have MIDI in and MIDI out. MIDI in is just for the sync, so it's playing tied to the DAW. And MIDI out, you can also record all your MIDI notes, so you at least, and you can also record all the filter settings and stuff. But I personally don't do that, because then you end up adjusting filter cutoff, and you know, and we all know where that ends. You change the whole synth, and then you change everything, and the vibe gets lost. So that's what I really would recommend also to you, just record everything. So that would be like the first patch, kind of the boot scene. You know, the really the key is here, second envelope, a fifth higher than the first one, and then the glide only on the second oscillator, which I don't know if every synth can do it, but I think it's, you can manage it with a couple of synths. The next one is like one patch I use, like I really love it. And now it gets important, Maybe you can switch over to my computer one more time. Thank you. That I have here the delay time. It's like a dotted eighth note. Okay, I'm gonna initialize this patch, do like this initially thing. Just press this button. It's initialized, and I'm gonna do what I explained in the beginning, turn up decay, turn down sustain, turn up release. We have a nice note, turn off all the oscillators except the first one. Okay, we are at the initialized setting where it's good. And the dotted eighth, it's like not delaying every eighth note, it's just delaying every, it's an eighth and then not the next eighth, but the eighth after that. So it's like more of a groovy thing. I'm gonna show you how it would be with a normal eighth. It's, of course, you can only recognize it like in context with the beat. So this is the dotted eighth delay. Sorry. King, 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 you know? And now I'm gonna make a straight one. Ding, 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 and that's like, I'm a computer, you know? So I don't like that. And now the interesting part comes. You have this arpeggiator section here, and like really the arpeggiator is like, that's like my go-to feature of the Moog, of course, filtering and stuff, but you sync it, and then there's here, you turn it on here. Okay, sorry, I'm not gonna explain like all the knobs, okay? And now it plays quarter notes. So I put the delay on, it's not that clear, wait. And then, if you turn it up just a little bit, just a tiny little bit, you know, it's really a little bit, there it gets to the dotted delay, dotted eighth delay. It's like the quarters, then the dotted eighth, and then the eighth straight. So what it's doing now, you have to listen with the kick. And I'm gonna compare that to eighth notes. That's really straight, and like the dotted eighth. You know, that's more sexy. And now, okay, let's stay at the arpeggiator. You can decide how many octaves you wanna arpeggiate the whole sound. So now it's just the same octave as you press the key. Now you can plus one. Now it's plus two octaves plus the one you press the button, so it's three octaves. So, and the thing is, it's a monophonic synth. You can only press one note at a time. It cannot play any chords. So what I like to do, okay, I'm gonna, these drums are annoying me a little bit. Let's turn this shit up. So, what you can create with the delay is like kind of a semi-harmonic thing, because the delay delays the note over the other. So if you play now more notes, for example, like a simple C minor triad, I'm gonna make it one octave higher in the, here you can transpose the whole octave, basically. So it's now delaying in the same rhythm, that eighth dot delay rhythm, as this one is playing over the other note, and then it gets like a chordy feeling, like the whole Moog. Also, what's really nice, just a short step into like piano playing is, you can either make a C minor like this. Wait, I'm gonna show you the keyboard. Or you press it like this, you just transpose this up here, and it's still a C minor, but in an, it's called open chord voicing. And it just sounds more open and not that standard, kind of. So, now we're gonna just make some basic filter adjustments. Turn down the, okay, so I'm just gonna turn down the filter, cutoff filter here. Okay, no sound anymore, everything filtered out. This is always the same process, right? Turn down the sustain, turn up the decay, turn up the release, turn up the envelope amount, so frequency, so it's working. More. starts only one note at a time, maybe longer. You know, because if you have the decay time too short, it sounds really unnatural. There it sounds good, you know. The release time maybe longer. This release time is of course only working if this release time is also turned up. And now it starts to get really musical. And now if I play chords, are delaying over each other, which sounds like okay, and then that's just, you know, it's just one oscillator, there's no pitch detune, there's no second oscillators on it, there's not a lot of filtering, which we can add now. And this is just, and you know, really, I would now, okay, turn on the kick. That's what I would do now is really just Moog in, zack, record it. Start with a low filter setting so that you can barely hear it. Now I'm only turning the cutoff. Sub-oscillator for oscillator 1, which is just square wave 1 octave below the first oscillator. So without it, with it. And then you jam, that's where you have fun. Like the octave range, so I go down to lower octave, make something more bassy. And then you go up 3 or 4 octaves and make a melody. Go down. So what we can do now, for example, is mod 1, if you have a Moog, is initially hardwired software-wise to the modulation wheel, so it's only working if the mod wheel is turned up. So we're gonna add a little bit of pitch amount to all the oscillators, and then we can, you know, we get this vibrato feeling, which you can also add in the end of your synth tail or your synth jam. So I'm gonna show it to you. That's basically it. Then you can we can go in different tonalities and stuff like that, but then you just play whatever you want. Basically, in really basic triads in this open chord voicing, which I showed you, work super well, and I really just transpose like the C minor chord. And then I go to the F minor, and I really just transpose this voicing here. Also be like a start of a song idea, you know? Okay. Low cut. So, from that, we leave the settings just like that, and I want to show you, I would recommend to you that you start playing a lot more with the arpeggiator, because it's your friend, and I mean, I'm practicing like the piano, and it's really hard to play, for example, tight 16th note in the tempo of 120 BPM. So if you really are good, if you play really tight in that fast tempo, then you're a proper piano player. So what I recommend you to do is just, you know, turn the tempo of the arpeggiator up, and then it like the Moog arpeggiator, you can press it like a note anytime and it will sync to the next 16th or 32th or whatever note, whatever rhythm you dialed in here. So that's really nice. Yeah, and so now I turned it up. I don't know exactly where. Doesn't matter. I'm gonna listen to the kick and yeah, then it's also just, you know, playing around and I'm gonna show it to you in a second. And here, maybe you can film it more closely. Yeah. There's like this, you can have like an up, down, order and random mode of the arpeggiator. Now I play like with the settings we had at the moment were up. So it starts with the lowest note and then goes up. But what is really nice is also the random stuff. So it's just deciding on based on the mood of the Moog, whatever, which note it's playing. So how does this is sounding like? No, and that's like when I'm gonna continue it a little bit actually. So this is really what's here important is that you just jam around a little and get a feeling for when do I have to press so the arpeggiator kicks in at the right time, and then it makes musically sometimes a really good sense. So I'm just gonna try stuff here. I don't know what I'm doing at the moment. Just change the reference note in the lower register. So you know, that's really nice. And what I also like is, you know, we still have this long release time in the end. So you can kind of play a melody in the bass at the same time. Hit at the right time, so the arpeggiator wasn't kicking in. So that's like you have to get a feeling for when the arpeggiator is, where the timing is. But you can just try it out at home with whatever synth you use. Arpeggiator do all the work actually for you. You're just playing a couple notes and it's transposing it over the octave and getting more nice through that. Yes. What's also interesting harmonically. Fucking kick, Alter. It's annoying. I found that yesterday, that pattern. I have to see if I can do it at the moment. It's a different tonality, don't get confused. So when you first record the root note and the fifth of a triad, for example, in this, this would be like an F major. We are in A minor, only white keys now, and I only play the F and the C. And the C. And then I play like the A minor, but without the third. F major. Like your starting pattern, and then after that, I recorded that yesterday, maybe in a little bit in another rhythm, but that's really important. Then, which are crazy nice. Okay. So this is like the what I just played in a slightly different version, but only root and fifth, and then after that, after you recorded that, you're gonna add in the third of each chord when you play the melody over it. So that's, it's necessary to have kind of a melodic understanding to where the chords are then at the moment. But if you have that, you can make a really, really nice melodies on top of it. So I'm gonna just watch which one is starting. So now it's F. Film yeah, here for a moment.
Robert, could you say, could you show the laptop?
Perfect. So now we're in A, so we need the C. Now we're in F, so we need the A as the third, right? And then I'm just gonna play like those thirds over the right chords, and then you can hear what I mean. Yeah, and then again here, please. I like that. So that's, you know, I'm always not always making nice melody, but then I some yeah sure.
Where's the mute?
There's no mute. Okay. Da, 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 da. Yes.
Yeah, I know. I walked in like a bit late. But
yeah.
I'm no just. Are you running the dry signal from the Moog mm-hmm. and into the DAW, and you are controlling the reverb and decay from there? Or because I saw, I think that's, was it Valhalla?
Yes.
So it's a dry signal from the synthesizer?
Yeah. The synthesizer itself is dry signal into the interface, which then gets into Ableton, which sounds like this. Sorry. And I said at the beginning that I really like to start also with the effects on, so you have instantly like a more of a feeling of how the end product is gonna sound like. And that's a Valhalla reverb, vintage reverb. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with the Sub 37, mm-hmm. but is there a reason why you're not using the onboard effects? On the
there are no onboard effects.
Oh, there
effects,
are no onboard effects.
Yes.
Okay, all right, yes. Okay.
I would use them if
right.
they were good.
Okay,
I
got
don't
it.
Know. I've right. never played a Moog with that has FX. I think the Moog 1 has, but I don't know. Yeah, so there are no FX in there.
Yeah, okay.
I really recommend Valhalla. I mean, everyone knows that they're great. But you can use everything in the end. You know, it just makes the synth really nice. And what you do, what's important if you don't have like the sub at home, I mean, you can do really this with every synth you have. The important thing is that, like this release thing I was showing you, you know, that the notes decay a lot. If your synth, you're using your VST or whatever synth that you profit, if it's not in a monophonic mode, if you press a different note, it decays over the first note, and then you get like a harmonic, you know, confusion in the end. So what you can do on synth is, for example, in Omnisphere it's called solo mode, or in Diva it's called mono. It doesn't reduce the voices the synth can use, but it says just one note at a time can be pressed. So that's important that you enable that, otherwise this long releasing thing is not working for you. What's time? That's not 12. All right, so another thing, Butzin does a lot, or I hear a lot in his tracks, is it's actually just a really long glide time, which he uses before he goes into. We're gonna just use this as a reference track, kind of. He starts low, and then when he gets to like a drop or a break, he's turning the glide up a lot, going in a high register, and then he's pressing like whatever melody note is fitting actually. Stuff, so I'm also a drama queen. Playing is really important, so you can have a really nice patch, but if you are not able to play kind of harmonically stuff, maybe it's sounding really nice, but you really have to develop your own ear for harmonies. And I started playing piano with 17, I'm now 23, and practiced 2 hours every day actually, I did it a lot. Now I have problems with my Sehenscheiden, because of too much practicing. And but then what I also like to do is just without the arpeggiator, you know, you can like arpeggiate it on your own, kind of. Yeah. No. So we have the same basic settings. We turn up the envelope amount. Maybe a little bit long. And this, like this envelope amount knob here, this is like really where, you know, you can do like the really mellow ones. You know, this is like, this is really chill, and if you go down an octave, if you turn it up too much, you know, then it gets like bangerish. If you want to do like a banger, you would do like that, but I'm more into moody stuff, so maybe turn up the multi-drive just for the sake of making it louder. It adds a little bit of distortion, this knob. It's not super important. So, plus D. And you hear the delay is really important for that patch, you know. It just delays over the other notes and goes down. So I really like to interact a lot with the synth. That's also why I like the analog synths a lot. You know, you can just really get your own feeling and turning knobs fast and getting different results in a couple of minutes, actually. Why is this having such a big latency? Also, I think Utsin is doing a lot, like playing really fast high notes. And it's just what I explained to you a couple of minutes ago. It's just the same three notes at the top. Then go down an octave. Arpeggiator, but if you need it. Nee, I don't have the time in my mind. I'm just gonna continue until someone is gonna kick me out here. You can do whatever you want. Also with the arpeggiator, I mean, I can play the scales, you know, I'm not a pro pianist. You can really, I mean, you have to put effort in it, but you have to put effort in music if you wanna do it properly. And yeah. Turn on this, I can this. Ah, what's also really nice, so if you turn the Fres oscillator really down to, I mean, it's marked here with the 16 or whatever. And then you turn in the second oscillator really high. Yeah, you turn it on here. Make it loud so you can hear it. Just same tone, not, you can shift the frequency of the second one to a fifth or whatever interval you want. But same octave, basically. And what now is interesting, if you just use a little bit of filter amount, you don't really hear the second one at the moment because it's so high, it's just filtered out. So if you now turn up the envelope amount, then you're gonna hear the second one kicking in, and that's like making this patch really nice. I'm gonna show it to you. Sound we had the whole time. If you turn it up, you hear this note is now singing more on top. That was which wasn't in the scale. So if I take it out, the second oscillator, sounds like that. And if I take it in, you know, you have this really high. And then of course you can push it to the fifth. It. Can go totally crazy. You can also, what you can do is like while holding something, like an arpeggiator. Shift the octave knob here. Mark and me did in a track was we had this arpeggiator, just one note. Yes, so so I made this concept. It started with the basic patching. And
what is this?
This is food actually. Because at my home I don't have an eating table, I only have a studio table. And I showed you this once, and then I wanted to conclude it all, you know, and so there's no conclusion. There's just, I hope, you know, guys, get any analog synth, just jam around with it, it's so much fun, it's handy, it's just get delay, reverb, you don't even need a beat for it, you know. I'm also more thinking about making like audio sessions just with playing the Moog, you know. And get piano lessons if you want to be like more into this like harmonic stuff. And yeah, I'm gonna make a masterclass for Production Music Live, which will come out next year, so you can buy it and get more information there, or you come to me or message me on Instagram. I'm gonna give you all tips. Any more questions? Maybe one, two questions, I don't know. If not, yes?
Does it have noise?
Oh yeah, yeah, that's a good question. That's the only bad thing about the Moog.
If it has noise, and if yes, how do you use it?
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's, okay, 1 minute maybe. That's a really good question. It has noise, but the noise, it's a pink noise. So, without noise, and if you turn it in, it gets only, literally it gets just shitty, because they put it in because the musician said that pink noise is more musical than white noise. But what you can do is you just put like an Ableton vocoder on top of it, and please switch to my computer, and then you see it, so here you have bands and you pick four. And then you make just your own noise on top of it, you know?
So you don't use the...
No, it's really not nice. I don't know what they thought. I heard you. Maybe you can just make it, open the whole Moog and just change it yourself, but... Yeah, because there are too many low frequencies in it, and it just messes up your whole synth. But you know, you can just do your own noise there. Yeah. Yeah, sure. You just put a vocoder in here, Ableton vocoder. Sorry, this is really the last thing. And what's important about the vocoder is it's like by default on 40 bands or something. By default, but that's not a nice setting. Right? Sounds like that with 40, but if you do it to 4, it gets more like a noise, no? Then you turn just the release down here. It's so long because the release of this note is so long. You know, and then the wet, dry and wet, just turn it down. There's your own. Own white noise. And it's nice because you can even modulate it externally from the Moog. I think that's also how I don't know it, but I think that's also how Bolzin is doing it, because his white noise on his Moog sounds really a lot too good for this one. Yeah. Good. So have a fun.